The Industrial Revolution and its consequences have been a disaster for the human race. They have greatly increased the life expectancy of those of us who live in advanced countries, but they have destabilized society, have made life unfulfilling, have subjected human beings to indignities, have led to widespread psychological suffering, and the third world to physical suffering as well, and have inflicted severe damage on the natural world.
Question. What do you think was one of the most important resources for the Industrial Revolution? Of course, besides child labor and a healthy amount of lead paint. If you said coal and steel, well, you're probably right. But I would argue that there was one other crucial material that was really needed to make all the machines of the Industrial Revolution running. And that material was rubber. Rubber valves, those seals for the mason jars, tires, rubber hoses.
Rubber walrus protectors. Call the police.
You get the idea. It was a vital and valuable material. Without it, production of all kinds of products would be impossible. Do you really think the Victorian people would have this beautiful arsenic-infected wallpaper without rubber? Yeah, I don't think so. So, you might be wondering, what actually is rubber? I mean, does it grow on trees? Well, actually, yes, it kind of does grow on trees. Rubber comes from the rubber tree, and the way that you harvest it is by cutting up the bark and collecting the sap. You would then process this sap over an open fire, making a kind of big rubber ball. That in turn could be molded in all kinds of useful things. Now, here comes the problem. The only place on Earth where you could find a rubber tree was in the rainforest in Brazil. If you were a European in need of rubber, you would be completely reliant on the locals. Half of all the Europeans that came to the rainforest of Brazil to explore, or in this case tap rubber, died in the first year of things like malaria or yellow fever, or sometimes even attacks of the natives. Okay, so maybe set up some plantations. It's a lot safer for the Europeans, they don't have to go out in the woods, less chance of them dying. But that was also not an option. You see, you cannot make a plantation of rubber trees in Brazil because there's a fungal infection, and if you put the trees too close to each other, in no time they will get infected and they will die. And that meant that the only way that you could get rubber was by tapping wild rubber trees. So it remained a dangerous and lonely job, with many rubber tappers having to go into the jungle on their own and only seeing other people when they came to collect rubber. And even though this was a really good paying job, there were not many Europeans that were willing to risk their life for it. The British government looked at this situation and decided that they had to secure this valuable resource. What they really needed were some seeds from the rubber tree so they would be able to make their own plantations in Southeast Asia.
Rubber plantation.
With blackjack and hookers.
However, as you can imagine, the Brazilians were not that willing of giving these rubber seeds, seeming that they were making fat stacks of money selling rubber to the English. Luckily for the British Empire, there was one man that had the expertise to get these seeds. That man was Henry Alexander Wickham. Henry was a British explorer, a real-life Indiana Jones in the time that being an explorer still meant something. He went to the Amazon to contact tribes and make a fortune. His first plan was to find exotic bird feathers for hats, which was a fashion at that time.
Oh my god, bro.
Oh, hell no.
But he couldn't find any tribes that were willing to help him. So when he went out to hunt these birds himself, he used too much force and basically blew up every bird that he was shooting at, making the feathers absolutely useless for hats. Henry then started in the rubber trade, tapping and smoking rubber. And he was quite successful with that. And successful, what I mean with that is he didn't die in the Amazon. When Henry came back to London, he started to write a book about his experience in the Amazon. One of the things that he was writing about was also the rubber trade. And you have to understand how lucky the British government was that Henry Wickham had this information and had this knowledge. Henry was one of the only Europeans that tapped and smoked rubber and came back to tell the tale. Like I said earlier, half of the Europeans that entered the rainforest died. So that already kind of limits the candidates for this mission to steal these seeds. And you would also need somebody that had knowledge about the rubber tree. It's pretty important to be able to find the correct tree and not come back with seeds from a completely different tree. So again, that kind of limited the candidates. The British government contacted Henry Wickham's and asked him if he could collect the rubber seeds for them. Of course, they would pay him for his efforts. Henry took this offer, hoping that when he came back with the rubber seeds, he would be able to oversee his own plantation in one of the colonies. Now, this was not going to be an easy task. The seeds from a rubber tree only fall once a year, and if you wait too long with collecting them and then planting them, the seeds will rot and won't be able to sprout anymore, so timing was of utmost importance. Besides that, the trade of rubber was a huge economical boom for Brazil, and even though there were not any rules or regulations about the export of rubber tree seeds, if you were caught smuggling these seeds, well, let's just say that the locals wouldn't react really happy when you tried to steal their livelihoods. So when Henry returned to Brazil, he had to be extra careful to make sure that there were not many eyes on him. He went around and asked multiple rubber tappers if he could gather the seeds for scientific research, so to not get any suspicion. Then he asked the Brazilian government permission to export 70,000 academic specimens. This was a term that was mostly used for dead animals and plants. And on March 1876, around 1 year after he arrived, he got lucky. A British ship arrived right on time when the seeds were falling. Henry Wickham then collected the seeds and set back sail to England, with over 70,000 seeds as their cargo. And even though that number seems kind of overboard, it was a good thing that he had that 70,000 seeds, because of the 70,000, only 2,700 germinated. And these 2,700 seeds, they kickstarted the rubber plantations in Southeast Asia. The fungal infection that was killing the rubber trees in Brazil didn't appear on the other side of the world, making this the first time that it was possible to make rubber plantations. And when these plantations started going, they were the most effective way to collect rubber, ending the Brazilian monopoly on rubber. So what happened to Henry Wickhams? I mean, he must be a hero of the empire and got everything that he could ever wish for. Well, this is the sad part about the story. Yes, he got the money, but after delivering the seeds and risking his life for it, he was basically ignored. All the expertise about the rubber trees and about tapping the rubber trees was all of a sudden not needed anymore. Henry offered his expertise multiple times and requested if he could oversee one of the plantations of the trees that was using the seeds that he collected. And it was not even that he was rejected, he was just straight up ignored. And I just find that so crazy. This guy provided rubber for the British Empire and was just completely ignored. His achievement was not even acknowledged. Let me just tell you how crucial rubber is, for example, with the Second World War. Germany couldn't get large quantities of rubber. And you might think, well, that's not a big deal. But if you want to motorize your army, then you need those tires. The rubber situation for Germany was at one point so bad that they would import trucks just to take out the tires so they could use the rubber for example, the tanks. Britain, thanks to Henry Wickham, never had this problem. Henry Wickham did get some acknowledgement 30 years after he stole the seeds, when at the age of 80 he got knighted. He also received a small pension as a thank you for the contribution to the British Empire, even though his actions brought the British government an enormous amount of wealth. He died 2 years after he got knighted, and he's buried in an unmarked grave. Thank you for watching till the end. If you enjoyed this content, I would really appreciate it if you could leave a like or a comment. It really helps me out. And if you want to see more content like this, then make sure to subscribe.